It is my pleasure now to introduce one of those teachers that the ripples have gone so far beyond his students, but have inspired and motivated an entire country. For more than two decades, Fredi Lajvardi, a high school science teacher, has engaged, motivated, and challenged students by making science fun and introducing them to the field of robotics. In 2004, Fredi and his team of underserved high school students drew attention from local and national media outlets when they defeated leading universities, including MIT, in a national underwater robotics competition. That inspiring story led to the acclaimed documentary Underwater Dreams, which was selected by President Obama to screen at the White House in honor of National Robotics Week in March 2015, was adapted into the major motion picture, Spare Parts. With an effective leadership philosophy, incredible story, and spirited passion for teaching, Mr. Lajvardi offers valuable and inspiring insight on fostering teamwork, sparking creativity, helping individuals realize their full potential. Please join me in welcoming Fredi Lajvardi.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say it's an extreme pleasure to be here before so many distinguished people. I'm a little nervous because it's always with your peers that you're always, you know, a little bit shaky about, so I'm going to try to be as calm as I can. I'd like to start off with a trailer from the movie because that's how I kind of segue into how the story goes.
Jobs in the last year.
You'd probably guess what my follow-up question is going to be.
Where do I get my stamina?
4 months. If you last that long, it'll be longer than most of my permanent hires.
Really? Nobody's going to crack open a book?
They're in there.
Why do they lock this?
So we don't steal them.
Are you for the engineering club?
I'd like to enter this.
The 5th annual underwater robotics competition.
So you want to go up against the best tech schools in the country?
It says they scout for internships and jobs.
You guys got some ground to make up. The other teams will have more money than you.
So you're still short $432.54.
And my man ate a couple ice creams on the way in.
Can I have an ice cream?
Too late. I already wrote the check. Okay, we gotta find cheap, creative ways to build this thing.
How do we fix it?
We gotta stop this leak.
It's small and really absorbent.
Every day, in 100 ways, they are told that they are worthless. That they are beyond hope.
The more they need me, the more I start to wonder, am I gonna let them down?
You remember everything you said about not giving up?
Well, we're not giving up.
He's full of surprises.
I saw something like this in a horror movie once.
Duke University, Virginia Tech, MIT, and Carl Hayden Community High School.
This is it.
We couldn't do this without you, sir.
Those are my boys! The finish line always appears. Think about how far we've come. And everything that we've gained, that no one can take away what we started together.
Is go talk to her.
Are we looking at a teachable moment?
Sure.
Hey, I'm trying to show them a lesson about rejection. I need you to slap me hard.
I can't just slap you out of nowhere.
I think women are all horrible teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Oh!
Yes, I like it. Thank you.
First of all, I want to make sure the timer's running so I don't get in trouble. I want to go on record as saying I've never been slapped, so that's a Hollywood creation. It was a great pleasure to be part of making that film. One of the things I hope that you guys get to do, if you haven't seen the film, please go see the film. It's not going to be an Academy Award winning film, but it does show how a teacher gets involved in the lives of their students. And the other reason is all the special effects done in that movie were done by high school students because the film had a very low budget. So you should go see it because of that. A little bit of information about the school where I come from. I'm not going to dwell too much on that because I'm sure many of you are familiar with what the typical inner city school problems are. So I'm going to spend very little time on that. The thing that amazes me the most is that every year that students are graduating, I always hear this. I'm the first one in my family to graduate high school. And I would thought, after being there for 28 years, that that would kind of change, and it's not. Every year, that's the same thing. Most of the parents haven't gone through high school education, much less even gone to college. So it seems like I'm kind of in that little neighborhood that is perpetually in this situation. Highest crime rate in the state, low test scores, you got the whole idea of the inner city school problems. One of the things that shocked me when I first started teaching at Carl Hayden High School is how fast the students would give up as soon as something got tough. And another thing that was interesting to me, it was I was a science teacher and I thought science was the most exciting, fun thing that you could do, and I was looking at my students bored to death because of what I had to teach in class and what subjects, the standards I had to reach and all that. And I just figured, you know what? I need to play with kids in science because that's how you see how pragmatic science is, how useful it is, all the different things you can do with it. So I basically started an after-school science club. And one of the first things we did were the science fairs, and that kind of worked, but we weren't reaching the number of students. I wasn't reaching that critical mass. I basically was getting the one kind of student, you know, for lack of a better way of describing it, I was getting the nerd student, and I wanted the general population as much as possible. So then we started this electric vehicle program. And on this, I saw some really interesting things, like pulling in mentors from outside, because I didn't know anything about how to build electric cars. So my students would then be in contact with professionals out in the field on what kind of batteries to select, what kind of motors to use on the rope, on the car and such like that. The most important thing was seeing the mentors work with the students. So I was pulling in people to help me do my job. Also, the communication or the interrelationship between, you know, like you were mentioning, the workplace, these were skills that the students were learning and the employees were getting to show them what they need to do in order to do a job, a long-term project successfully. So we did that for about 10 years and it worked great. But I still wanted to see if I could reach a broader group of students, because now I was pulling in more students, but still not a wide enough diversity. I found this program called the FIRST Robotics Program, and FIRST was created by inventor Dean Kamen and Professor Woody Flowers, and FIRST stands for Inspiration and Recognition of Science and Technology. And what they saw was an alarming trend in the United States where kids weren't going into the STEM fields. And they basically warned that if we don't produce the students that go into the STEM fields, we're going to lose the standard of living in the United States, and we won't be number one in the world in science and technology. So they started copying the sports model because they saw how many students were bouncing a basketball for 40 jobs in the NBA every year. And yet you have 2 to 3 million jobs a year go unfilled in the United States in the STEM fields. So they copied what seemed to be working, and that was to create a robotics competition. FIRST Robotics now is in approximately 10% of the high schools in the United States. And what I saw working with that was fantastic. We had the boys, girls, the nerds, the geeks, the computer guys, you name it. We had basically what I thought was a critical mass of the general student population. And it worked great. Then we decided to try another program. And the reason for this was FIRST Robotics was kind of seasonal. And we thought, this is great, this is fantastic. We've basically found extracurricular STEM. So we were able to work around the big, large school system, which takes a long time to move different policies through. Basically, after school, if you have a club, you can move like the wind. If you want to build a robot or for a specific competition, you can easily do that. You don't need 5 different boards to approve it and all the funding and all that. With the robotics program or extracurricular, you go out, find sponsorship, and you're ready to go. It's as simple as that. So we wanted to find another competition to kind of fill the spots in the time of the year that we didn't have FIRST Robotics. So we heard about this competition called the MATE National ROV Championships. It was another teacher and myself. We went to a workshop during the summer where they told us all about this competition, and we decided we were going to give it a shot. Now, one of the things that we learned by working with the kids, and you would think, you know, having a college degree, I would have known this, but I didn't. And that was, we learn the most when we fail. And so by this time, we had done robotics for 2 years, and we thought, okay, if we're going to do this new competition, how are we going to learn the most? So obviously, we thought, we need to fail the most. So there were two categories we could pick from. There was a university category and a high school category. So we thought, okay, we're not going to win the first year. We've never built an underwater robot. Let's take the stress off the table. Let's make this a total learning experience. We're going to enter the college category, and we're going to go there, and we're going to take as many notes, because if we get beat by the best, we're going to learn the most, and then come back the following year and see how well we can do. So that was our approach. We had no expectations whatsoever on anything that was supposed to, you know, happen as far as us winning anything or placing. And it's in hindsight, it kind of released our imaginations, because the students would come up with ideas for solutions that, if the competition was, you know, something they had to do well in, they said, well, maybe we should do this, because if we take a chance on putting our computers and batteries on board the robot, if it leaks, then we're out of the competition. Whereas in the approach we were using, it made no sense to put all your batteries on the surface and run 15 or 16 different cables down to a robot. Then you have all the weight of that cable. That was the industry standard. That was the ROV paradigm, the remotely operated vehicle paradigm of the time. We, on the other hand, thought, well, that's dumb. You only want one wire coming to the surface, and it has maybe six filaments in it, like an Ethernet cable, and you're able to control the robot without having to have all these heavy cables dragged through the water. So that's what I mean by it freed up their creativity. They were able to solve the problem without worrying about what place they were going to get. So we ended up going to a competition that had three components to it. So one was the technical writing that you had to turn in a report 2 weeks before. It also had an oral presentation that the kids had to give. And keep in mind that English for the students at our school is a second language. So again, no expectations of doing anything. And then there was the underwater portion of the competition, where the robot was performing. So just to give you an idea, they had to measure things underwater. They had to collect a sample of a fluid underwater. They had to measure distance, identify different objects. So there was a whole set of skills that they had to accomplish. Now, early on in the competition, you know, I posted a list when we were getting ready for the competition. I posted a list of all the students, the schools that were going to compete in the competition. And I thought it was cute, because they were listing all these universities and MIT, and there was Carl Hayden listed. So I'll come back to that list later on. I just wanted to make sure I got that in there. One of the things I was trying to do is, you know, show the kids again, look who we're competing against. These are the schools we're going to compete against. And so we'll come back to that later on. So what happened at the competition? We go to the competition, and the first part's the underwater portion. The actual robot itself has to compete. And we watch team after team go and fail many of the tasks, and a few were doing well, and we saw, you know, MIT go in and they did the most tasks, and then the next best school was Cape Fear Community College, who had a degree in underwater robotics technology. And then we go in, and to our surprise, we ended up third place in the underwater portion. And we were ecstatic. We were thinking, wow, our experience in FIRST Robotics, and apparently our approach was not as bad as we thought. We thought, this is great, this is fantastic. And one of the things that we did that nobody else did, which I thought was phenomenal, was we were able to extract the fluid underwater. And no other team, including MIT, was able to do that. They were able to do more things than we were able to do, but that was the one thing that we could do that nobody else could do. And the funny thing is, we were never able to do that in practice. So I don't know if you want to talk about fate, that could be related to that. So we go to the oral presentation, and we're watching team after team go in. And 1 hour later, 45 minutes later, they come out. And they're going in with these big, remember, this is 2004, these big television monitors and models and graphs and charts and all this other stuff. And keep in mind, we weren't trying to compete seriously. We were trying to do well, but we weren't thinking we were going to win first place. So we kept everything low key.
We sent our kids in there with a three-ring binder that we turned into a stand so they can set it on the table. On the front, there'd be maybe a picture or a chart or something. On the back, we had three or four bullet points so the kids would not forget what to say. And we didn't want to worry about them setting up a PowerPoint or anything like that, because remember, this is 2004, so PowerPoint might work where you are, but you go someplace else and it's not compatible. We didn't want the kids to frustrate, you know, get frustrated with the technology. So we sent them in there, and like in 20 minutes, they came out. And obviously, we're thinking, God, they must have done it extremely terrible. What happened? So we started quizzing the kids. We said, you know, why you guys came out so fast. How did it go? Oh, it was fantastic. There wasn't a question we couldn't answer. They were really happy with us. And I said, well, you guys know you came out in half the time as everybody else. Yeah, but they ran out of questions. And so I'm thinking they were just being nice to you guys because they wanted to get you out as fast as possible. What did you say? Now, Lorenzo, he's kind of the joker of the group. He says, well, Christian kind of gave a smart aleck answer. I said, well, what did you say, Christian? He said, well, they asked us why we weren't using PowerPoint. And I said, kind of nervous now, well, what did you say? He said, well, PowerPoint's for people who don't have anything to say. So I'm thinking that probably wasn't the best answer. But I don't know if that's worth getting thrown out. What else did you say? And Oscar, the team leader, he said, you know, they were really surprised that we were so comfortable with the metric system. I said, well, the rules say everything has to be in the metric system. Why was that a surprise? They said, well, you guys looked, you know, extremely comfortable with it. And they asked us why we were so comfortable with it. And I said, now I'm getting a little worried. Well, what did you say? They said, well, you know, we all came from Mexico, and we use the metric system there. So I wasn't sure exactly what was it that caused them to get thrown out, or maybe they were afraid to tell me, but I couldn't figure out why it was so short. But nevertheless, it was short. So we end up going to the award ceremony. And at the award ceremony, they gave away a prize called the Judge's Award. And the Judge's Award, they made a big deal about saying, we've never done this before. There was this team that just really stood out. We felt like we had to give a Judge's Award. And then they announced it was Carl Hayden High School. So they gave us the Judge's Award. And right away, we're thinking, okay, this is the pity prize, because we made a big mistake by entering the university category, and we just got obliterated, you know, in the two other parts of the competition, and they didn't want us to feel bad, so they gave us something. So that's what we thought. And later on, I could do it right now. So here's the story about how that happened. We are actually able to find out 10 years later in the documentary, you'll see that we met the judges. And so one of the problems was the day before the competition we were practicing, the robot had a leak. And so we were worried that it was a small leak, but over a 30-minute mission time, it could cause a problem. So, and we didn't have time to redesign or rebuild anything, so we had to minimize the damage. So we were in a school van looking for a place to eat, and my partner, Dr. Alan Cameron, he said, well, you know, diapers come with desiccant. And the kids were like, what's desiccant? Okay, well, it's this powdery material you stick between the layers of the diaper so it could increase the absorbency like about, you know, 30 or 40 times. And that way, when you're carrying Junior's diaper from one end of the room to the other, all the urine doesn't drip out. So we're like, okay, well, that's cool, but we can't stick a diaper in the robot, so what are we going to use? And then I brought up how when we used to do electric cars, I knew other teachers that would make their students go buy maxi pads, and they would line the battery pods of the car with maxi pads, because in an electric vehicle, you can't have any of the ground of the batteries touching the chassis, and they didn't want the sweat from the battery or the sulfuric acid to cause a grounding to the chassis. So they used the pads to absorb the sulfuric acid that might come out of the batteries. And then Christian, who has sisters, brought up the idea of tampons. And all of a sudden, we're in uncharted territory. And we're like, well, how big are tampons? How much can they hold? I mean, so we had no clue. So we then were deciding that someone had to go into the store and buy tampons. And of course, they were all pointing to me. And I said, no, 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 no. I have a whole teaching career I got to get through. I can't be known as the tampon teacher for the rest of my life, so I can't do it. Plus, it's your project anyway. You should get it. So we kind of went, you know, through everyone's social status, and we figured out that for Lorenzo, it would actually be an improvement if he brought. So we voted that he goes in. And of course, when you're not the one buying the tampons, you have all the advice on how to buy the tampons, right? So we told him, you have to go into the store, and you have to say, look, we're in this underwater competition. And you have to approach a lady in the aisle and say, look, we're in this underwater competition, and we have a leak, and we're thinking about using tampons, but we don't know anything about tampons. Could you help us pick which tampon? So that's exactly what he did. And we're waiting in the van, and he comes running out of the drugstore with a box of tampons like it was a trophy. And just to show you how nerdy we are, we were all cheering for that. So then, being the scientists that we were, we wanted to know, well, how much does one tampon hold? So in the hotel room, they had these little Dixie cups, about 3 to 4 ounces of water. And so we decided we'd open a tampon, we're going to throw it in there, and to our amazement, poof, instantly, it absorbed the water. So we figured out about 3 to 4 ounces of water. So we calculated how much water would leak in about 30 minutes based on what we observed from the day before, and we strategically located the tampons in the robot electronics housing. Then when the robot came out of the water, the judges do an inspection, and they're looking at it, and he's making all kinds of expressions. He goes, is that what I think it is? And I said, well, it depends on what you think it is. So anyway, the judge's award was for the use of tampons. So then they came to elegance and design. And that award I can see because our robot did look radically different than everyone else. We had our batteries on board the robot. Everyone else had their batteries off board. So I understood that. Then they gave another special award for best technical writing. Now, by this time, I'm thinking, OK, someone messed up the spreadsheet. There's no way we could outright MIT in an underwater robotics competition. How is that possible? Then they went to the overall winners. And that's accumulation of all the points. So they announced third place as Cape Fear Community College. And we're thinking, they were third place underwater, so we're probably fourth or fifth, thinking that, you know, those judges' awards and the special awards might have gained us some points somewhere. And so they then announced second place as MIT. And so now we're doing the math in our head, and we're kind of figuring out. And I had a sickening feeling come to my stomach. Instead of being excited, I was getting very, very nervous. And here's why. Remember that sheet of paper I posted on the wall outside when it has the list of the competitors and the competition? Well, Lorenzo comes over the day I post it, and he says, what's MIT? I said, that's MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, one of the top schools in the country, if not the world. And he said, well, if we beat MIT, can you take us to Hooters? Now, you have to admit, as an educator, that's probably the safest bet on the planet, right? And we want to motivate our students. So I figured if that's his motivation, sure, if you beat MIT, I'll take you to Hooters. So by this time, I'm scared to death. So I pull Lorenzo by the t-shirt, and I said, look, if what I think is about to happen happens, under no circumstances, can you run around and start yelling, we're going to Hooters? And he said, do you think we won? I go, it looks like we might have won. He said, but you promised. And I said, I'm not saying I'm not taking you. Just don't announce it. It's not professional. I was desperate. I had to come up with some. So sure enough, they announced we won first place, and he turned around and mouthed it to me. So my lesson here, real quick, is be careful what you promise, because you may end up having to, you know, live up to that. So now, as you see here, it says the world finds out on the slide. That's kind of not actually how it happened. We got back from the school, or from the competition, we get back to school and we think, wow, this is going to be great. We're going to be in the newspapers. It's going to be, you know, some TV show or something like that. Zip. Nada. Nothing for 8 months. We had sent out press releases and whatnot, and you name it, nothing. If we had a fight on campus, we'd have 3 or 4 news trucks there interviewing a kid who saw the fight. Right? But if you beat MIT with kids on food stamps, nothing. So we didn't know why. And one of the problems was, you know, at the end of the competition, we had one cell phone. Remember, this is 2004. I don't even know whose phone it was, but they handed me the cell phone, says, you need to call home. And I said, well, what's the hurry? I'm talking to, well, no, you need to call home now. And so I'm thinking, well, what did you guys do to the phone? Why are you in such a hurry? So they then hand me the trophy, and I call home. So I'm talking to my wife, Pam, guess what? And she says, what? I go, we won the whole competition. We beat MIT. And she said, and this is, I quote, that's not possible. Now, that should have been a precursor or a warning as to what the rest of the world was going to think when they saw the press release. That's the only explanation we can come up with on why nobody took advantage of this. So this is 8 months later, a writer from Wired magazine contacted us and said, is it true that you beat MIT in an underwater robotics competition? And I said, yeah, you can call MIT and ask him how it felt. And he did. So then came the Wired article, and that's when the world found out, and the movie deals and whatnot. So the whole thing went on from there. Now, what that really did, it was great for those individual students. And I unfortunately don't have the time to go into what happened to them afterwards. You can catch me after this and ask me. But what it really did was made it impossible for any other student at our school to come up to me and say, well, we can't do that because we're Mexican. Or we can't do that because we're poor. Or we can't do that because our parents didn't go to college. Or we can't do that because we didn't have the money. Basically, if they don't want to do something now, they have to say, it's because I don't want to do it. So that's what I mean. And the picture you see there is 8 years or 4 years later, in 2008, we're at the US first World Championships, and we're being inducted into the Hall of Fame. It's for the award called the Chairman's Award. It's one of the hardest awards you can win in the competition. And also, to prove that it wasn't a fluke, we went back to the ROV competition two more times. And we got third place the second year, second place the third year, but all 3 years we beat MIT. And now I have, a short video.
They were a ragtag robotics team. Four teenage boys from Phoenix, Arizona, decided to build an underwater robot, just for the hell of it. They took their robot and headed west to a sophisticated underwater robotics competition, up against the likes of MIT.
When we arrived at the competition, I was pretty nervous.
The other robots were like pieces of underwater jewelry.
We looked like the carnival had arrived. Just a raggedy-ass robot.
We were way over our head.
We noticed water indicates.
We're telling it to go forward, and the robot's going sideways, and I'm thinking,
oh my god.
Oh shit. We're out of the competition.
We were all having problems.
My idea was a tampon. This was a do or die situation.
MacGyver would be proud.
But the robot was only the beginning.
Who are these punks from nowhere that had no business doing what they do? You know, what is that?
They broke the mold and said, catch me if you can.
It wasn't about building a robot.
The 2004 team showed us that it was possible.
No matter what background you come from or where you are, you can do what you set your mind to do.
Kids at Carl Hayden High School become leaders.
They have a sense of social responsibility that was cultivated as being part of this team.
Knowing you can't do something just because you're lacking a piece of paper is kind of devastating.
What the robotics did to me is to show me, even though that I don't know where to start, I can solve the problem.
We should empower as many people as we can to build great things.
These boys laid a foundation. They inspired those behind them to see that possibilities could exist, to be courageous, to dream, and to fly.
I want to solve the energy crisis.
Make a difference in my community.
Be a computer engineer.
Develop
the renewable energy infrastructure.
The next generation of autonomous vehicles.
And make them go faster. Prosthetics for kids.
Discover, like, alien life.
I want to be an astronomer.
So I still find it amazing that I'm actually on stage getting to tell you the story, and that there's a book that recounts the whole story, a documentary, and a movie. And if that wasn't enough, there's now going to be an IMAX film coming out in February promoting STEM education, and we're one of the featured stories in that as well. And so I have a few things that I want to leave you with. So I got to make sure I don't forget any of them. Number one is that talent in the United States can come from some of the most unlikely places. So don't ever write off any part of the population. The next one is make sure you take full advantage of the diversity of the population you're in, because you never know where that next great idea is going to come from. And this one, which was also alluded to in the previous presentation, inspiration and motivation are probably one of the most underrated elements of the public education system in the United States. There's not any new program that I'm aware of that focuses on inspiring and motivating the teacher and inspire and motivating the students. In my experience, if you do those two things, everything else in education will take care of itself. How can I say that with such conviction? It's because I see it all the time with the students that I work with. The next thing is having meaningful relationship with the students. And I don't mean like a Facebook relationship or a 50-minute classroom teacher student relationship. I'm talking about the 3 hours you spend every day after school working with kids, teaching them how to solve problems, and learning how to solve problems side by side with them. Those are the kind of relationships that develop that mentorship and that focus on how to get the kids ready for the workforce. The other thing, and this has been alluded to too, these long-term projects, I came across a term that I really like. It's called three-dimensional learning. It has content, social and relative relevance, and then it's also involves some kind of physical activity involved with it. When you have these long-term projects, it tends to invoke all these three areas, which is what makes the education experience deeply ingrained. The last thing I'd like to leave you with, and it's something that I came across on a Facebook posting for when they were doing a promotion for the movie. And it was, now you know why marketing people are paid so much, because it was such a great line, I had to steal it. I figured I had the right since the movie was about us, so. And it is what we do. And it's basically, if life doesn't give you a dream, build one. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you. It was a pleasure.